cool this morning. Like, for real? And I slept good last night, and I woke up, and I was like, it's morning. But it's so good to be here. I want to encourage you. As you know, we really try to get started around that 8 o'clock hour. Invite your friends. Invite those who are been looking for a church home. Invite people who don't like church. A lot of people, it's the format of church that they don't like. It doesn't fit with them. So invite those people that have been struggling with church. Some of your family members that used to be in church, but they fell out of church. Invite them to our 8 o'clock service. We try to hold it to that hour point. There's not a lot of preliminaries. And we'll just get into the Word of God. So please, 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 we thank you for all that you do for this service and your support. Want to just give let you know that one of our trustees passed away a few days ago, Lloyd Blackwell. The funeral services for him will be this coming Saturday. 11 o'clock will be visitation, and 11:30 will be the funeral right here at MAU. So please pray for the Blackwell family. There are a lot of connections via the Rudds, Mevin, all that. It's a big family that's been infected by this. Brother Blackwell, 62, I believe. 62 years old, so definitely young and a great impact. So pray for Myrtle, Mother Myrtle, and also Victoria, his daughter, and sons, and all the family, but those that you know that are here. Amen. Do you love Jesus?
Amen.
Wendy. Amen. Come on to your feet, please. Come on to your feet. I'm not going to say anything. She already knows. Come on to your feet. Come on to your feet. This morning, as we're just in this time of worship and a cappella time, I think we're going to go into number one, so we may just worship and go into number one, holy, 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 thinking about God. But I want you to think about holiness. Holiness means to be consecrated or set apart to God. Consecrated or set apart to God. That means that I'm connected with God, so everything that I do always strings to God. And that's what walks in holiness is. It's not that I shout all the time. It's not that I'm loud all the time. It means I'm connected with God 24 hours, 7 days a week. That's why we come. We come to worship together, not for entertainment purposes, at least here at Ebenezer. We need to hear a word from the Lord. We need songs that warm our hearts. We need a time that we can give, that we can reach out to affect people that we may not know. This is what worship service is all about. So at this time, I just want you to think about your life, that you have life, that you were able to wake up this morning, that you're able to talk. I've been dealing with some things all week long. The fact that I'm able to talk is a wonderful gift of God. And so as we go into this worship service this morning, I just want you to just focus in, whatever takes you to that level of focusing in on Him, being holy to Him. Let's get there. Let's worship. Changing. We need more of you. Holy, holy, the saints adore thee.
All the saints adore thee.
Casting down their golden crowns. God, just a hand clap for praise. God has just been so real good to us. If you could grab your Bibles, we're going to go ahead and run right into our gifts of love. I'm going to give you a scripture via that. If you could open to Proverbs 15 and 27. As you get there, God has just blessed us tremendously here at Ebenezer. Those that are part of Ebenezer know those blessings. Those who are visiting, we are a blessed church. And presently, we are a debt-free church. We believe in being debt-free. It's been tough. It's been hard, especially with the pressures that are on outside. So we ask you to pray for us. But I thank you for your liberal giving. We hold forth that New Testament principle. God loves a cheerful giver. And we want you to give from your heart. Yesterday, we went to Mayflower, my family and I, to get something to eat. And, of course, you would know that we went to Mayflower, right? But we went to Mayflower to get something to eat. And they always think that we're a party because we go in there like 15 strong. We roll up into the place. And, so when they do that, some restaurants, they go ahead and put gratuity on there. And I feel so bad for the server simply because if she puts gratuity on there, she's going to get less than we would give her or him. And so the whole process, because we want to be free givers, and we always ask, did you put gratuity on there? And they go, yes, and they're smiling like, that was a bad idea. But that whole process of giving needs to be not just on Sunday, but every day of the week. So we thank you for your giving. This is a new start, this 8 a.m. service, so thank you for sowing into it. Look at that Proverbs 15, 27, one verse today we've been going through, just pieces of Proverbs as we look at giving. It reads, he who is greedy for gain troubles his own house, but he who hates bribes will live. Let that resonate in your heart. He who is greedy for gain troubles his own house, but he who hates bribes will live. The reality is that we have to be careful. We like money. Anybody like money? Anybody want to raise? Can anybody handle about another $100,000 a year? Y'all are like, oh yeah. It's not talking about just having money. It means that push for money. Selling out for more money. And that's tough. That's our society. Even in the church, pastoral business, so many pastors are leaving churches for another church that can pay more. So they become greedy for money. And it can slip into anybody. You can be the most saint that loves the Lord and everything, and before you know it, you can be chasing after money. You can be after gain. So we need to pray for ourselves and everything that we do. We're driven on a commercial society. That's what it is. It's buy this, buy that, buy this, buy that. If you get this, you will be that. But don't believe the lie. Please note that God is the one who provides for all of our needs according to his riches and glory. And anything else that we get over that, man, we should be praising and exalting God and giving him all the glory. That scripture, he who is greedy for gain, you just bring trouble to your own house. But he who hates bribes will live. Don't sell out to money. I talked to your family the other day. They said they're giving away everything. I'm like, what are you doing? They said they just want to have a new start. They just want to give away couches. They want to give away everything to give and just have a good start. And you know what? I was encouraged by that, that people are coming to that point realizing it's not about stuff. Some of you, we had shops you dropped yesterday. You need to give all your stuff away. Amen. Amen. It's all junking up your house. You can't even move. You got a little path going through the house. The garage. No thief can steal anything because they're going to get hurt trying to get in there. I'm sorry. I diverted. Come on, officers, to the front so we can pray. We can pray. I'm going to ask one of them as they give us directions for the offering to pray over the offering and our mail corps to get ready to give us their number one selection. If you don't mind, you can sit with your loved ones or somebody you don't like. It doesn't matter. We just ask you to come on down. We don't get this opportunity a lot within our 11 a.m. service for our choir to be able to sit down with their family members, so we can allow them to come down. And we're going to try to continue to do that as long as we can as God blesses this service. Just greetings to all of you that may have come in late. We've got some that I haven't seen in a long time. Mother Akins, welcome back. She's a bionic woman. She's got all new parts, and we're just happy to have her back. The whole Akins clan being able to just worship. We've got the Howards that are here from out of town. So many people, if I forget you, it's just charged to my mind and not my heart. You notice Keith, he's sporting a new beard today. He's got the gray going on, and it matches his jeans. It's just amazing what God is doing. Well, it's time to preach. Anybody ready for God's word? Amen. If you grab those Bibles and follow along with us. Mark chapter 1, and around that 21st verse. Then I want you to go down, once you get that section, that's going to be our starting scripture. We're going to focus in just at that 24th verse. So Mark 1, that 24th verse. While you're looking for that, heads bowed, I ask you to go on a word of prayer with me. Father, thank you for who you are, Lord. I am just amazed. I'm amazed at what you're doing. I'm amazed at how you move. I'm just amazed. Lord, I pray for maybe there's someone here that's not saved. Would you help them to confess with their mouths the Lord Jesus and believe in their heart that you raised them from the dead, your son, that they would be saved. Let them know it's by grace that they're saved, not of themselves. It's a gift from you. Lord, we thank you for that wonderful gift. Now, Father, you know my infirmities, my hang-ups, my sins. I ask you to forgive my sins and cleanse me of all unrighteousness. Lord, I ask you to do what you can do, only you can do. So I welcome you, Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, you've never failed us. I thank you for that. So would you teach us? Would you guide us? Would you lead us into all truth? Would you make this word so plain, so easy to be understood, that even a small child can be transformed to be like you? Lord, we just love you and magnify you. Lord, allow your anointing to seep deep within us and through these scriptures today. Lord, give us exactly what we need for the rest of the day, the rest of the week, or the rest of our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Mark chapter 1, I'm looking at that 24th verse, it reads, saying, let us alone. What have we to do with you, Jesus of Nazareth? Did you come to destroy us? I know who you are. The Holy One of God. Look at that 24th verse again, saying, let us alone. What have we to do with you, Jesus of Nazareth? Did you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God. I want to speak simply from the subject on today, the Holy One of God. The Holy One of God. Already defined that as we went into our service today. We've sang number one hymn, holy, holy, holy. Holiness means to be consecrated to God, to be connected to God. That means that everything you are is focused in on Him. It's my concern as I look at our society and especially our churches that the holiness is being lost. There's so many things that are out there to gravitate our mind, to take our attention off of the Lord. If some of us were honest, we could stay away from church for weeks and weeks and weeks and be encompassed by other things that just grab our attention. And one of those things, and I'm not putting it down, but it's true, is our cell phones, our mobile devices. We're always on them. It's amazing how much this little thing in my pocket consumed my time.
It's amazing how many emails come in. It's amazing how many texts come in. And besides all that, you've got all these nifty games, Tony, that you can play with that gravitate you. We got things that buzz across colors and they just go in. The other night, Joy, she had hers out and she was playing this game and I was just kind of looking. It was just androids or something that was just going back and forth and all of these things to gravitate our mind, to take us off of our focus of life. And so many times we feel drained and we don't even know what's happening. Here today, Jesus is into his ministry. He's started around that age of 30, and now he's just chosen his first disciples. He's called them out. They didn't choose him, he chose them. It's amazing because he could have chose better ones than he chose, but I'm so glad because that gives me hope. It wasn't the high societal ones. It wasn't the ones that had all the degrees. He chose the ones that were broken, were busted, disgusted with life, and he wanted to turn them around. And we know the end of the story. Even in that, they would fail him, but it's not about them. It's not about us. It's always been about the Holy One of God. One of these miracles that we're going to deal with is demon possession. Notice that 21st verse, then they went into Capernaum, and immediately on the Sabbath, he entered the synagogue and taught, the Holy One of God. Now, this is important, giving us an idea of what's going on. Matthew and Luke mention a visit to Jesus' hometown of Nazareth. We know that was his hometown. But prior to that event, we find out in Matthew 4:13 informs us that Jesus' residence was actually in this city that we're dealing with, Capernaum. Capernaum was a city by the sea, a beautiful place there, and Jesus had moved in, though he didn't stay in any particular place. This is where he always focused back. But notice as he comes in, Mark gives us this feel of urgency. As you look at your life, are you urgent about something? I told my family last night, I said, we're leaving at 7:01. That's what time we're leaving. We need to get here, get some things in place. We're leaving at 7:01. Got a long day. Got to go to Shady Grove this afternoon. Got 11 o'clock service, 7:01. And it produced urgency. You should have seen our house. They waited to the last 5 minutes and you know, running here and there. We didn't get breakfast or anything. But about 7:04, we were in George, that's our big van, going to Ebenezer. We need urgency in our lives. We need something to shoot for. When I see someone just kind of walking around with no focus, I'm concerned because that's when the enemy can come in. I'm telling you, you know, when you see those young men and young women just out on the street, just hanging out, no focus, you know, just sooner or later, there's no good that's going to come to that. There's an urgency immediately on the Sabbath. Now, the Sabbath here at that time in the scriptures is Saturday. That's when they worship. That's when they lifted up God. They had all kinds of laws to make sure people worship on that day. We live in the New Testament side that we can worship any day. We choose Sunday to worship him because that's the time we believe that Jesus got up. But in essence, we see in the epistles, we can worship him Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday. We need to worship him all those days because we need to be focused on the Holy One of God. Here, as he's here at this city by the sea, we notice what he does in that. Look at that. He goes in there on the Sabbath, and he goes into the synagogue, and he teaches. Why did he teach? Because the people's minds needed to be open to a higher level of truth. Now, there are a lot of teachers out there, and sometimes they're giving you their opinions, they're giving you their heart, per se, but we need more scriptures. We need to be able to see the scriptures for ourselves because the scriptures examine who we are. The scriptures open up the intents of our hearts. How many times have you read a scripture and you said, I didn't see that? Or through that scripture, God began to speak to your heart. Jesus understood because in John chapter 1, he is the Word that was manifested in the flesh. I need you to feel this morning. Can you imagine being in that synagogue and Jesus the Christ, the anointed one, walks in? He looks just like everybody else. There is nothing, Isaiah said, there was nothing that made him more significant to anybody, but the Lord, the Christ, the anointed one, the Holy One of God, speaks. And when he spoke, we're going to find out, hearts began to melt. That's what I need. I need, I thank God for preaching, proclaiming. Thank God for wonderful singing and testimony. But I just need a word. I need a real word to massage my heart, because there's sometimes during my week, I can't get my praise on. I can't lift up my hands per se because of the situations that I'm in. But the word digs deep down in my heart, and Jesus teaches them. The people, can't you see? They've been broken. They've gone through. There are many that are in poverty and issues in their life. But yet when this man of God walks in, it's refreshing. It's like a cup of cold water when you're thirsty. It's like a good chicken wing when you're hungry. It does something for you. It changes everything when you hear that right thing. Look at verse 22. And they were astonished at his teaching, for he taught them as one having authority and not as the scribes. We're going to work our way backwards here. The scribes were very, very, very legalistic. They would go to that Pentateuch, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy. A lot of them, as well as the Pharisees, had memorized those. So they would just kind of stand there, and they were going to go line upon line, precept upon precept, which was really good, but there was no connection. They would read it, but the people couldn't see the picture. They would read it for themselves, but they had not yet been transformed. And when you're reading something and you haven't been transformed, it shows that you're not intimate with it. Any amens in the house? I can always tell the husband and wives that are having problems, because when they come into the church, even though that they sit near each other, I can tell that they're not intimate. I can tell simply because there's something that's cold. You ever seen brothers and sisters fall out? Come to the same church, and you know it ain't right. You know something ain't right, because they won't look at each other. You blood, and you walk right past it, and you don't even look at each other. You shook the person's hand beside the brother or sister, and they said, that we see this, there was no connection, but when Jesus stood up, this is a big word here, they were astonished. They weren't just blessed. It blew them away. When you get used to old teachings with no life, when you get used to, that's what they had to have. Remember, the laws made them go on the Sabbath to worship, so they were required to just sit there, and all they were thinking, when is this going to be over? But this day, when life came out of the Christ, it blew their mind. They were astonished because the same scripts that the scribes used, now Jesus used them, and they could see the picture. They were astonished at his teaching, for he taught them, we see the second part of them, as one who has authority. Not as the scribes, he taught it the way it was supposed to mean. He taught it because he was the word. He taught it because he was connected with it. And my concern for the church is we're here worshiping today, what's in our hearts? What are we portraying when it comes to Jesus, the Christ, the anointed one? Are we just talking about Ebenezer Baptist Church, or are we lifting up Jesus? Are we just talking about, I go here and I go there and I'm a Christian, or are we living the Christian life? Do people know and sense there's something different about us? There has to be something different than maybe our hair or our clothes or our shoes or the car that we drive around or the house that we live in. There must be something that's innate inside of us that when people get around us, even when we don't say anything, they know that there's a difference. He has authority because he is the word. He speaks it. Look at verse 23. Now there was a man in their synagogue with an unclean spirit, and he cried out. When the word of the living God is powerful and anointed, it will call out the demons. Yeah, it'll call out folks that got issues and struggles. And I've seen over and over when the word comes, sometimes people just begin to weep and cry because the word found you out. yeah, the word went into your house, and it went into your bedroom, and it went into your mind, and it began to deal with you. And as Jesus is teaching, it is so powerful, it's so anointed, all of a sudden there's someone that's been coming Sabbath after Sabbath, sitting in the synagogue, and he cries out. They never heard anything from this guy, it seems to indicate, but when Jesus comes in, something changes. The atmosphere changes. Man, I love that. I love to go visit different churches, Catholic churches, Lutheran churches, and I see the ideas. I see people, and they sit there, and they've been programmed. They've been programmed to go through, you know, this, the liturgy, and they get up, and they sit down, and they go, but there's no connection with a lot of people. But every now and then, it doesn't matter where I go, in the Catholic or Lutheran, there's always an undercover Holy Ghost person. You know who they are. You know they... They ain't supposed to say amen loud, but because it's so quiet, they stand out, and they're like, oh God, I wasn't supposed to do that, because they are connected with the word, and even if there's one that doesn't have the anointing, they've already spent some time with the Lord, and they can get something out of that. And here this man is there in the synagogue, and he has an unclean spirit. Now, we don't want to infer too much from this. Unclean in the Greek, it just means he was demon-possessed. He had a demon on the inside, and I believe in demons. You may not believe in them. I believe in demons, and I believe that demons sometimes come to church. And I have to deal with those right here in Ebenezer. They come in, and they're looking for a good worship service. They're looking for the same old, but when the Word of God comes, sometimes it troubles. It causes a cry out. And I'm wondering sometimes we may mistake those who are Holy Ghost filled with the demons that are crying out. Y'all ain't hear me today. Can I just take a little bit of time on this? The unclean spirit had been there in the synagogue. I need you to get this picture. He had been there Sabbath after Sabbath, as I said before. But this time, when the word came, something breaks. Look at this. As we see this demon crying out, verse 24, saying, "Let us alone. What have we to do with you? Jesus of Nazareth, did you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God." That's what we're talking about, the Holy One of God. Now, I am amazed. I'm really amazed that a demon gives praise to God before somebody else in the synagogue. The other folks were astonished, but the demon cried out. Can we have this thing flip sometime? Could the devil have moved into our worship services, taken over, and those who are true believers, holy unto God, have sat back quietly? Look at this. He speaks up in the middle of the teaching. I was in South Carolina. I used to go to a church in South Carolina. I was deacon there, and it was rumored. John Williams, he was preaching. He was my pastor at that time. He was preaching. He was going at it. He was getting their second gear, and he was in that hoop, South Carolina hoop. He was just rolling with it. And he said something in his message, and all of a sudden, it was this older lady, she's going on to be with Jesus. I hope she is. Going on to be with Jesus. In the middle of his sermon, her name was Sister Peaches. Sister Peaches, true, I kid you not. Sister Peaches sat on the front row, and in the middle of his sermon, she raised her hand. Went to worship and pray. She had a question. And we had a small congregation. It wasn't a whole bunch of people. So when she raised her hand, it was significant. And I'm sitting there going, oh, my God. She really raised her hand. And I'm like, Pastor, did you see her? I'm thinking in my mind, did you see? And he's trying to just ignore her, and she raises it high. And he tried to ignore her, and Sister Peaches spoke out in the middle of the service to get his attention, this whole process here. And I'm concerned because this demon actually speaks out in the midst of the teaching, and he gives us a whole information of who he is. He starts out, look at this plurality, let us. What do you mean, let us alone? We don't see in these few verses Jesus really doing anything but what? Teaching. He went into the synagogue and he taught. He wasn't messing with folks. He was teaching. But when the word of God is rolled, it'll touch you. It'll mess with you. It'll mess with you. So now the demon speaks out. He makes himself known. He said, let us alone. I believe the interpretation here, me and theologians would agree with me. He's saying us, the man and the demon. Now we see in other scriptures that there were a plurality of demons that possessed a person, but here it seems to indicate maybe this was one, maybe two, but the us was, we are in unity. We've had this man for a long time. He's been under our control, therefore we speak together. And my concern for the church in these dark days, you got to be careful. I don't believe that a Christian can be possessed by demons, but I do think that Christians can be influenced by demons. And you can deal with the wordplay all you want. We need to be careful that we're not being directed by a demon and just speaking what the demon wants us to speak. We need to be careful that our choices have not been laid out by a demon and we're walking in something that God never wanted us to be in. How many times have we made choices and then weeks later we look back and said, that was terribly wrong. Could you be influenced by a demon that was speaking in your ear? Let us alone. I found out when the word of God comes, when I encourage people to read the word of God, it'll either draw them or drive them. Yeah, I find out people that are struggling going through, I say, are you reading your book? If they're reading the book, they're going to get stronger. If they go away from the book, they're going to get drier in their life. They're going to get weaker in their life. Leave us alone. We don't want to hear that anymore. We don't want the word anymore. Put the scribe back up. We don't want the anointing of it. We don't want the life of it. Leave us alone. Then they say this. This is amazing. What have we to do with you, Jesus of Nazareth? They came to the synagogue, right? The demon inside of man came to the synagogue where they were supposed to be learning about the Messiah. But yet when the anointing comes, they don't want anything to do with it. Could that be when our worship people come to the church, but they don't really want Jesus? You're not hearing me. You're not hearing me here. They come to the place, but they want everything but change. Don't mess with my lifestyle. Don't mess with my choices. Don't mess with my cursing. Don't mess with what I'm looking at on my TV. Don't mess with anything. I'm just coming. I'm going to put my money in. Not too much. I'm going to put it in. Leave me alone. I don't want to be changed. I'm satisfied. You're messing with us. What have we to do with you, Jesus, now? We don't want anything from you. All we want to do is just come here, deal with the law, and go back to our miserable life. That's all we want to do. I was in a funeral yesterday, service yesterday, and I saw so many people that had made life choices different than what the scripture said. And they sat there, and I'm like, how can you sing this song? How can you dare sing this song? Because I'm challenged with the same stuff that you were challenged with, but when I got changed, I became holy. Let us alone. We don't want anything to do with you. Then they do this. This is deep. Did you come to destroy us? Did you just come this Saturday to get rid of us? This is a higher level. It means that Jesus had the power to destroy demons. I'm telling you, this is going to set you free because some of you have some demons that are snooping around in your life. I want you to know you got more authority than you realize because you got Jesus on your side. You need to speak to that devil. Minister Super, you know what I'm talking about. Sometimes there's some demons that are on your track. Why are you living with them? Why do you keep allowing them to ride in your car? I'm not telling you to get rid of your husband or your wife or your kid. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about that thing that's speaking into your life. Why do you entertain it over and over and over and over again? Speak the blood of Jesus upon that thing and you can come out of it. You got to know that God has authority and power. Did you come to destroy us? And then they say this. Look at this. I know you, who you are, the Holy One of God. Now it changes here. Notice we have plurality. Did you come to destroy us? And then I. A separation occurs. It seems to indicate the demon separates and speaks out by himself, I know who you are. How do you know who you are? From the foundations of the earth, before demons were even created, God was. Would you walk with me in Genesis, that first part, let us create man in our own image. That the demons knew them. Demons are just fallen angels. When Lucifer rose up and decided that he wanted to be like God, God said, no, we're not having that. We're not having that. And he kicked a big portion of the angels out of heaven, and they became demons. So the demons already know who Jesus is, even though he has a different outside. Do you know the folks that are walking around you? Some of us only know them by what they look like on the outside, but as a Christian, you got to be able to have discernment and see what's on the inside. Man, I'm trying to teach my kids this. I'm trying to walk in this. Everybody who smells good and looks good may not be good. Are you listening to me? How many of you have been hurt by somebody who looked good on the outside, but they were messed up on the inside? They spoke the right things at first, but their spirit was demon-possessed. I know who you are. And then the demon says, the Holy One of God. Nobody else said this, but the demon. And it's an exclamation mark within my scriptures. It means that he got excited. You are the Holy One of God. Have you come to destroy us? In essence, it's not our time yet. Why are you here? The Holy One of God. Look at verse 25. But Jesus rebuked him, saying, be quiet. Come out of here. A lot of interpretation of this, but I just think simply he just got tired of the demon talk. Yeah, remember he was doing the teaching, powerful teaching, people were astonished. Now all of a sudden the demon speaks up. Their attention is diverted from Jesus to the demon. That's what the devil will try to do. Get your attention off the word of God and get your attention on other stuff. Never say the time. I'm not picking on you. We're in church, the house of the Lord. Your family members already know you're going to be in church, but yet they're going to call you. They know. You told them I'm going to 8 o'clock service. It ain't nothing but 8 to 9, a little bit over. Will you leave me alone? Yet it's an emergency. So you pick up the phone because it's vibrating, buzzing, and ringing. You walk out the back to talk, and all they want to know is where the Cheerios are. That's a diversion. You done missed something that could have changed your whole life. He said, okay, that's enough talking. That's enough talking. I need you to be quiet. And there's sometimes in your life, you got to put the do not disturb button on the door. I'm just talking to the smart iPhone people. That's all I'm talking to. And you got to tell your phone, you got to tell the devil, be quiet. You got to tell your mind, you're not going to disturb me. You're not going to keep me out of worship. You're not going to keep me from praising. You're not going to keep me from loving. And you push the button, plead the blood of Jesus, and you press on because the Holy One of God is working on your behalf. You got to do it on your job sometimes. Your people will get there and chat, all this. They always chat. But yet they make you some money, some blue money. You're going through. You just put the do not disturb on because they will drive you crazy. All the devil wants you to do is lose it. All he wants you to do is just curse one time. Because you curse it one time and people who thought you were so holy and saved and sanctified will cause a stumbling block, and some of them will take years before they get back to the house of the Lord. Do not disturb. Be quiet, saying, come out. Be quiet, leave. Now the issue is, he's not telling the man who's possessed to leave, but he's telling the demon to get out of the house that the man is. This is important. When demons possess people, they see that body as a house. They see it as a place of residing. A demon is not comfortable without a place to reside. That they can. I don't mean to go into demonology or get you all upset, but they're always looking for a place. And it even happens in church service. I'm very concerned. Some people they're in the house of the Lord and they're in casting out spirit services. You need to be careful. Don't be running in them services. I'm telling you, unless you call. Because if it is a demon possession, when that demon comes out, he's going to win. Y'all ain't hearing me. I I ain't playing with that. I ain't playing that. You casting out demons and you doing all of that, where he gonna go? Because everybody, instead of saying everybody's not saved in that, and he looking. And that's sad to come to church every Sunday and you picking up the demons that the preacher casting out. Come out of him, verse 26, I gotta press on. And when the unclean spirit had convulsed him and cried out with a loud voice, he came out of him. Demons don't like to live. Even though this is the Son of the Living God, the Most High, when Jesus said come out, he had to come out, but he was the last fight. And some of you are dealing with addictions and things of that sort, please know, if you just gotta tell the demon, you got to go. But the demon is gonna press you. He is going to struggle with you. Notice this. He convulsed. That unclean spirit, he convulsed him. The guy. That means that he went into kind of this wriggling, this writhing within him. And he cried out with a loud voice, but it came out of him. I don't care what I got to go through as long as the demon leaves me. I don't care the struggles that I got to consider deal with headaches or body issues. Just get the demon out of me. And some of you done that. You had to go to a doctor and they said, if we take this out, you're going to feel much better. And it gets to a point with so much pain in your life, you said, just take it. I don't care. I know it's going to hurt for you to take it out. But if you can get this thing out, my level of existence will be better. And notice at this point, the demon leaves, but he produces pain. Verse 27, then they were all amazed. So that they questioned among themselves, saying, what is this? What new doctrine is this? For with, there's that word again, authority, he commands even the unclean spirits, and they obey him. We've never seen it like this. Scribes would come in, nothing happened. We come in, jacked up, we leave jacked up. We were comfortable with that. We were happy with that. We knew when we rode up on our wagons and our mules that we were going to leave the synagogue the same way. We had came to accept that. But now, things have changed. Man, I don't want that. I don't want to be caught in the same old, same old. Any amen to that? Amen. That's why I keep loving my wife. I don't want the same old, same old. Steve, I don't want the same old, same old. I'm serious. My wife and I, we're getting older by the second. And I just can't dare just seeing us doing the same old, same old. Sometimes I just switch it up. I just ask for something different. Or just kind of push her something. Or go hug her. Just follow behind her. Smell her. So I just. Y'all are just me and y'all need to help me out. I don't want the same old, same old. They had gotten used to it. The same thing over and over and over and over and over, but yet they didn't get any different results. But they were happy about it. Because they didn't even know any better.
That's
right. Isn't that sad? I think many people are coming to worship and they're happy because they're not getting in change because they don't know what change is. They don't know what a fresh word will do for you. And they get happy in that existence, but really they're sad. They're amazed. And they begin to talk. Now we hear the other folks talk. When the demon leaves, now they start talking. Can't you hear the murmuring? What is this? Because they wake up. I'm telling you, there's not a whole bunch of people asleep during Ebenezer services, but I'm looking as I get older. I'm telling y'all, need to pray for me because I'm going to sneak up on somebody. And just yell. I'm telling you, now they wake up. Look at that. They wake up. They wake up and they say, what is this? Because remember, the demon yelled, the demon cried out, the man convulsed, they're woke now because now adrenaline is flowing. Now they're connected, now their mind is awakened, now they realize something different is in the house. For with authority, he commands even the unclean spirits and they obey him. It seems to indicate that they had missed maybe this man had an unclean spirit. Or they knew he had an unclean spirit, that he came every Sabbath, and they were okay. How many of us have been become comfortable with unclean spirits? The demon didn't hurt until Jesus said, come out. See, demons are okay long as you let them stay there. Long as you let them do a majority of what they want to do, it's okay. And sometimes we get used to that level of existence. Notice these last verses here. It says, and immediately his fame spread throughout all the region around Galilee. Man, when you see this, life has changed.
Yeah.
I don't want to hear from scribes anymore. Just give me Jesus.
Come on.
I'm not satisfied with just a cursory reading, but I need to feel it.
Yeah.
I need to feel it. I go some places and I'm telling you, I tell people just read the word. Since I got a connection, I know the Holy One of God. Give me the word. But it is so refreshing when someone preaches or teaches or testifies or sings a song. And I know it's just not a cursory memory, but I know they've been changed. I know that they've been connected with it because it's making a wheel roll on the inside of them. And it's like a water flowing over. It's like a bubbling springs. And no matter what I've been going through, I can get encouraged by what I hear coming off of their lips. The casting out of demons became a regular event in the life of Jesus, for he truly was the Holy One of God. But casting out demons didn't fix the plight of man. I can cast out every demon that's in here. I pray that there's none in here, but there might be. I can cast out every demon that's in here, but the problem is it still doesn't change your heart. It just took the influence out of your life, but your heart is still messed up.
Yeah.
So inevitably, listen to me, this is what's going to happen. Inevitably, if I cast a demon out, if your heart is not changed, other demons are going to come in.
Yeah. Yeah.
Look at this. Jesus would make this statement in Matthew 12:43 as we hurry to our conclusion. When an unclean spirit goes out of a man, he goes through dry places seeking rest and finds none. Then he says, I will return to my house from which I came. And when he comes, he finds it empty, swept, and put in order. Matthew 12:45, then he goes out and takes with him seven other spirits more wicked than himself. And they enter and dwell there, and the last state of that man is worse than the first. So shall it also be with this wicked generation. Talking about the Holy One of God, how many have come to the church and demons have been cast out, but they never were filled with the Holy One of God. Therefore, instead of getting better, they got worse. We got people that are throwing oil, doing all of this stuff, doing all of these things in service, but yet people aren't getting saved, sanctified, and filled with the Holy Ghost. Therefore, all they're doing is opening up a clean house, and the devils are coming by saying, this is a nice house. It's been cleaned up. It's been swept up. And then they talk to the buddy devil. They say, you know what? We want you to come on in and move in. It's all cleaned in. And they ask somebody else, and now the last state of the man is worse than the first. But I'm so glad that the Holy One of God fixed that by going to the cross of Calvary. 1 Corinthians 2:8, if the enemy would have known that Jesus' death would have moved someone greater into those swept vessels, he would have never took part in his death. If he had known that the nails in his hands and the nails in his feet was going to permanently move demons out of folk, he would have never done it. He would have never allowed it to done. But I'm so glad today that God was smarter than the devil. Are there any amens in the house? There ought to be some folks that's been delivered from demons that can say hallelujah. God, thank you for dying on the cross of Calvary. He died, but he rose up with all power in his hand so the Holy Spirit could move inside of us. Acts chapter 2. Aren't you glad that on the day of Pentecost, the Holy Ghost came down as cloven tongues of fire, and it filled them from the top of their head to the soles of their feet. That meant that no longer could demons move in anymore, because the Holy One of God took all space. My question today: who lives on the inside of you? What's inside you? Come to your feet, please. Let us alone. What have we to do with you, Jesus of Nazareth? did you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God. I'm going to ask our deacons, our ministers to come forward. First call is, as usual, salvation. And I want you to accept Jesus Christ truly within your heart, because I'm not trying to scare you, but I sense the demon activity is escalating. The demons are becoming more bold. It says, as Sodom and Gomorrah were, so shall be in the last days this time. I'm seeing it. And Sodom and Gomorrah, it scares me. I'll be honest. I know God has not given us a spirit of fear, but a power, love, and a sound mind. But it scares me when I think about Sodom and Gomorrah. They had become so brazen. They would knock on a door, the men, and say, give us another man that we can have sexual relations in broad daylight. That's brazen. It said that the angels that they had mistaken for just mere men had to lock the door, had to blind the people. And even after they were blinded, they still groped at the door, trying to get in to rape the angels. That's the level of demon possession can come to. And I'm seeing it more and more. Anybody remember the days and times that people would just do their stuff in the dark? That was y'all. But now, 24 hours, 7 days a week, some people even look at pornography in church. We need Jesus. Salvation, if you're here, would you quickly come to the altar? Salvation, you're saying, I believe. Jesus, come into my heart. Come into my heart. Confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus. Believe in your heart that God is raising from the dead. You will be saved. Simple and plain. You will be saved. We're going to pray for you. And through salvation, the Holy Spirit comes in. Your place will be swept and clean, but God will move in. He'll move his furniture in. He'll move all pieces of him. That doesn't mean that you're not going to fight against some stuff. It just means that demons cannot move in. God controls that house. If you're here today, we invite you to the altar, second invitation. Maybe you're looking for a church home. You've been praying. We always encourage people to pray about it. God has moved on you to make this your church home, this 8 o'clock service, your focus. We invite you to the altar, Christian Experience, Olat Levin. Maybe you watched here. You're a college student. You're saying, I want to be a part of Ebenezer Baptist Church while I'm here. We invite you. And then that final invitation is for those who may be struggling with some things. We all are struggling with things, so I don't want to put you on the spot, but you got some challenges. That you know that things have been whispering in your ears, you've just been struggling, maybe attitude issues, addictions that have been rising back up, and maybe you just need to get to the altar. As we prepare to close today, we want to pray for you. We just want to pray a collective prayer. So come on, maybe you need to stand in intercession for a husband or a wife or a child. Our children are going through. They're struggling with some stuff now. And you're saying, man, I need to bring them to the altar today. Would you come? Would you come today? Would you come quickly? Would you come? God, it's me. It's me. It's me. Don't be ashamed. Don't be ashamed. This is real. This is real. This is real. This is real. I'm going to give you just a few more moments. A few more moments. A few more moments. Would you come? Would you come? You're saying, wow. Those that are standing, would you intercede for our nation? Would you pray for America? Please pray for America. In that funeral the other day, the Marines came in and they folded the flag, and I was on color guard. And the life wasn't there. The intensity wasn't there. And I'm seeing that within America. People are not standing up for the anthems anymore, walking out. We're in a sad situation. Those are our Marines, supposed to be our best, but they were not the best. I don't know what they were going through, but I'm thinking about the church. Where is the church? We need to be our best in this season. Mr. Brown.
Are you one of the holy ones of God? That's the question today. We all have to search our heart, including me. I have to ask God every day to sustain my life forgive me of my sins. But overall, we're going to pray that God continue to deliver all of us from our endurance or whatever it is that we may be going through. Eternal God, we come this morning, this Sunday morning, this beautiful day that you have set before. We want to say thank you. God, you have brought us through the rain and the storms. But we realize, Father, this morning, the storm and the rain keep raging in our lives. But we know, God, that you're a God that can fix anything that's broken. We ask that you search our hearts and search our minds. Not only that, God, I pray for the bereaved families all over this land and country. Let them know that weeping may endure for a night, but joy comes in the morning. Somebody that's around the altar need joy this morning. Maybe their heart has been broken. Maybe they have a confused mind. But God, you said that every knee must bow and every tongue must confess. That's why they bring it to the altar this morning. They're casting their cares on you. But God, this morning we thank you for the word that has been preached. We thank you for the messenger. We thank you, God, for the deliverer. Continue to anoint him with the fresh. Bless his household. Bless his church and members. God, we say thank you for being an awesome God. You still look beyond our faults and taking care of our needs. In the closing of my prayer, I want to say thank you for just waking me up one more time. We realize, Father, we could have been on our cooling board this morning, but you saw fit to let our moments roll on just a little while longer. And we say thank you. And Father, as we get ready to lead this altar, we pray that you will continue to just meet us there at that old rugged cross where you shed your precious blood for the sins of the whole world. And we will serve you. We will acknowledge you. But most of all, we will praise your holy name. In Jesus' name we pray. Let the church say amen. Now give God a hand of praise.
God bless you. Amen. God bless you.